Thank you so much for joining today's workshop. We're super excited to have you all here. My name is Hannah. I'm on the core team at the Bay Area Youth Climate Summit, and I'm super excited to introduce everyone to Nico Nagel, who is the East Bay organizer at SFHAC.
Cool. Hey, everyone. While I'm pulling up my presentation, got a couple of questions for you. So actually, I'll start here. I'm Nico Nagel. I'm the East Bay organizer for the Housing Action Coalition. I've been with the organization since 2017. Wow, time flies. Since that time, the mission has remained the same. We are a pro-housing nonprofit, advocating for new homes at all levels of affordability, looking to solve what's commonly referred to as the housing crisis. And we'll get into why that's a housing shortage in just a second. So real quick, I'm just gonna share my presentation. Hannah, if you're the host, can you enable participant screen sharing for a sec? Thank you. While we're doing this, could folks, I suppose I already have your names, could folks drop your preferred pronouns and where you're coming to us from today? I'm Nico Nagel, he, him, coming live from Oakland, California. Drop it in the chat.
Is it all good now?
Let's find out. Yep, folks see that? Awesome. Okay, so couple things off the top. I'm gonna try to run through this really quickly so we have sort of ample time for our breakout rooms. That'll be, I think, the majority of our question and answers. If there are a couple of questions intermittently, I can answer them quickly, but I think it'd be a great move to just save it till the end. Feel free to drop those questions in the chat, though, so we see them and remember them. Otherwise, this is Bay Area Housing 101. This is our sort of super high level what caused the housing crisis and how we can solve it together. Cool, so off the top, here's what we're gonna get to. How bad is it, right? I think we're all sort of aware that there's a problem. If you've read anything about the Bay Area, you've probably read housing crisis. We're gonna talk about how we got here, policy decisions that were made under certain circumstances. We're gonna talk about the solutions, what the policy decisions are and the actions we can take to help solve the housing crisis. And then we're gonna talk about what, more specifically, what we can do. Hopefully us on this Zoom, hack as a partner to folks in the community like yourselves. So how bad is it? So we have the highest rents in the Bay Area. We have the highest rents in the United States by quite a bit. I don't know if anyone here is looking to buy a house pretty soon. I know I'm not there, but we also have the highest price for those as well. So that's something to look forward to. We have rampant displacement. I think that's something we all have probably run into. And by the numbers, we're falling short across the nine counties by about 700,000 homes. 700,000 homes we need to keep pace with population. And the state is falling short by a much bigger number of 3.5 million homes. So we'll get into all of that. So let's start with the problem. What really is the problem? Well, it's kind of deceptively simple. The housing shortage led to an affordability and displacement crisis. Put very simply, we have not built enough homes for people to live in. And so folks who can't find a place to live, either because they're priced out or because there are simply not enough homes, are pushed out, either out of the Bay, out of San Francisco, or out of the state entirely. And I'll highlight here that what I mentioned off the top, housing crisis is a easily digestible term that describes a big problem, but it also implies that we don't have a solution, right? It's the oncoming train crash that you can't stop. That's actually not the case here. The upshot is we have a shortage. We can define the problem as we don't have enough homes. So a bit of a silver lining and really a place to start. So how did we get here? Simply, we failed to produce enough homes to build enough houses and units for folks to live in. And in that same amount of time, our population has grown, exacerbating that problem. To put some numbers to it, since 2010, the Bay Area has created about 850,000 jobs. That's a good economy. That's what you want. We have responded to that by only building 114,000 homes. That's an 8-to-1 ratio, which leaves some folks out in the cold. And that's the problem to solve. Unfortunately, right, we'll get into this, but it's a predictable outcome of policy decisions that we've made to not build enough houses for folks to live in. Just want to say that right off the top, very predictable. It's a problem. So graphically put here, we have a low supply of homes, so not enough homes, and a high demand for those homes, which is a bunch of folks want to live in the Bay Area. That drives prices up. We'll see that put here. What we're looking at here is population growth since 1950, population growth across the entire Bay Area since 1950, jumping from roughly 3 million up to about 8 million people. In that same time, adding in here the number of homes we've built for those people, we've only jumped from about just under 1 million to just under 3 million. So again, not enough homes for people. Here's the price of a home adjusted for inflation, that gray line that just jumped up on the screen, right? It rises as we don't build enough homes for people to live in and as demand rises. So that's what we're looking at. So again, we haven't built enough homes to keep up with population growth. A few other numbers for you. We've added, state of California has added about 500,000 people per year over the past 10 years. In that time, we've only added about 80,000 homes per year for those folks to live in. I think you can see the discrepancy there. So put another way, housing production hasn't kept up with job growth, right? In this case, we're saying a good economy means new jobs, means new people coming to the area. That's a good thing. We just haven't built enough homes for them to live in. Put one more time, right? We've created way more jobs than homes. If you're looking at this graph with me here, unless you live, you know, in wine country, your city, town, region has built predictably a bunch of office. It's gotten a lot of employment opportunities, which is all great. Just haven't built the number of homes to accommodate those people. And that results in what's referred to as a jobs housing imbalance. So you're sitting there, you're like, okay, I get it. You really hit me over the head with this information. You know, what else? Well, here's what else. Let's take it down to the neighborhood level here. Failure to build these homes has real effects. In this case, the graph we're looking at illustrates why building new homes, and new specifically new market rate homes, which is different than subsidized affordable homes, building new market rate homes in low-income neighborhoods is actually an anti-displacement measure. So the California Legislative Analyst's Office put this study together, and the graph we're looking at effectively says that communities, low-income communities where market rate housing was built between 2000 and 2013 saw lower displacement than those areas in which very little housing was built or no housing at all was built. So again, this is a real human effect at the neighborhood level. So, okay, so you're saying to yourself, all right, I believe you. Why don't we just build the housing? Yeah, great question. So that's what we're doing. At the highest level, we are, you know, it's a result of decisions that we've made at every level of government in the state of California, and we'll get into the federal thing in a minute as well. But I do want to highlight these are decisions we've made, and we can make better ones moving forward. So at the state level, there's a couple pieces of, you know, legislation, laws on the books to be aware of. The first one's called Prop 13. What it effectively does is creates a tax incentive for cities to build more office and less residential. The way it does that is, in 1978, this proposition came into law, and it capped the tax rate for every property where it was. So this is what you're paying for now. That tax rate would only reset, i.e. go up, i.e. earn more revenue for the city if the property was sold. Office space sells way more than residential space. And so it became a bigger driver of funding, public funding for cities. So cities as rational actors, as people who want to fill the coffers for the public, said, we're going to prioritize office space. That disincentivized housing to be built. We haven't built enough housing. The other one to be aware of is called CEQA, California Environmental Quality Act. I suppose this is probably what this group might have a bigger interest in. This was signed into law by Governor Ronald Reagan. It was meant to give folks in the community the ability to request a environmental review on a major project in their area. I think that sounds good to everyone. What it's actually ended up being used for is to block projects from being approved, or to block them from being built, even approved projects. The issue there is that that adds time and cost to housing getting built. And that cost and that time delay gets passed on to folks like me who are trying to find an apartment. I think both of these have good intentions sort of baked into them to some degree or another, but they've largely just been abused and need reform. So at the regional level, Bay Area has nine counties, 101 cities in those counties, and none of them have shown an interest or have an incentive to work with each other. An example here, I'm going to use the transportation example. My first year at HAC, I took Caltrain to BART to Muni to get to the office in the morning. And at no point on that transfer schedule did my trains line up. So at no point did I hop off one and get onto another. How many folks here have ever used multiple modes of transit to get somewhere else in the Bay Area? Okay, yeah, so you feel the pain. That's because there's 29 different transit authorities who all have their own idea about how to function and what to do. And those inefficiencies, the problems that they create get passed on to us, and it makes it more difficult to get around the Bay Area. Very similar thing happens with housing in terms of regional coordination. So at the local level, to get a permit for really anything, but housing is our specific bag today, it's incredibly complicated and burdensome. That's a large part of the reason why I have a job, frankly, is to help people get through that process, even if their project is by law a good project, even if it meets all legal criteria. It's very difficult. We'll get into this in a little bit of a bigger way, but zoning laws are antiquated and exclusionary. I don't think it goes too far to say they're segregationist. So we'll get to that in a moment. The permitting process. Here is San Francisco's permitting process. If you think this looks like chutes and ladders, it's because it is, really. There are a lot of arrows that point back to step one. There are a lot of ways to not get to the end and not have your project built. This goes for big projects, and this goes for folks who just want to put a small in-law unit in their backyard. It's just difficult to get things done, and that affects the number of homes we have. It doesn't have to be this way, though. Here's New York City's. Does anybody see an arrow going to the left? Few, if any. There's a lot of arrows that point to the right. This is indicative of a system that wants to build and wants to build right, wants to make it easy to build and efficient, to produce the needed infrastructure for a city that is really constantly growing. This is not impossible to have in San Francisco. We just haven't decided that that's the kind of system we want. So local zoning, remember a minute ago I said it's exclusionary. We're gonna get into that now. Very basic level across every city in the nine counties, zoning laws limit height and density, and that limits the number of homes you can put on any square plot of land. Right, it limits the overall number of homes we can build for folks to live in. They contribute to exclusion and urban sprawl. Who here thinks that having a diverse community is important, who thinks it's a strength of a community. Cool. Most cities, by the way, with these zoning laws, also say that. They also tout that. It's a very Bay Area thing to be all about diversity in a big way. And I'm here to say that our laws do not reflect that. One thing I'll highlight here, another question. In San Francisco, on the residential zoned land, on how much of that land do you think you can build apartment buildings? Do you think, if I said 80% of land, it is allowed to build apartment buildings in San Francisco, does that seem right to you? Maybe. How about 50? You could build apartments on half the land? Okay, that number is 25%, roughly. The flip side, it is illegal to build an apartment building, multifamily housing, in 75% of San Francisco. That doesn't strike me as how a city's built, but we'll get into that in a minute. One other thing to note, these local zoning laws are just sort of detrimental to surrounding cities, i.e. they push problems to other cities. So we'll get into that. So single family home zoning was very specifically, it was invented to exclude and segregate. It is a single family home zoning was established so that communities that were formerly governed by racial covenants could maintain that segregation. Racial covenants, by the way, literally written into law that says you cannot sell this home to a person of color. That is the set of laws that's being protected under the system of zoning right now. There's also, I'm not sure of it, but the topic is getting more broadly touched upon in the public eye, this concept of redlining. Historically, redlining was how banks and governments divided up cities, and they determined where the desirable areas were. They drew lines around those places, and they said, only white folks are going to get loans to buy homes here, maintaining segregation through the economy. How they did it. If you look at a demographic map of most cities across the Bay Area today, it looks roughly similar than the way it does in 1950. Proof of the effectiveness of single family home zoning. I really want to drive this point home. Who here knows the name Willie Mays? I imagine most of you. Who here has, if you're a Bay Area person, I assume you regard him as just absolute royalty. I do, so I'm going with it. He was, under this set of laws, he was not allowed to buy a home in San Francisco. He could start, win All-Star games, go to the Hall of Fame, but he was not allowed to live in San Francisco under this set of laws. That's what we're dealing with. So this set of laws, because it limits the number of homes we can put anywhere, it causes exclusion and displacement because folks who cannot buy into those exclusive communities have to go somewhere. They are pushed to the outskirts of the Bay Area or sometimes out of the state. I put it to you that next time you're on a BART train, you get to a stop, take a look outside the BART stop, and think to yourself, could there be more homes here? Could more people live well and get on transit easily and create thriving economies around BART stations here? Something to think about. The city of Berkeley, by the way, where single family home zoning was invented, literally invented, has 3 BART stops. And most of those BART stops are not zoned for strong residential communities with community serving retail. That's still a fight we have yet to fight. Lastly, I can't can't emphasize this enough. He who shall not be named here tried to make this a talking point of his 2020 presidential election, right? He wanted to win suburban voters, and the way he tried to do it was to say, Democrats will upzone your communities, they will allow multifamily housing, and in doing so, they will bring crime and people you don't want. And what he meant was not wealthy white folks. That's the rhetoric around single family home zoning. That's how this has been leveraged recently. Those aren't my politics. I'm gonna fight those politics all day. So lastly, if it wasn't made obvious already, there's a large racial element to the realities around housing. And I wanna qualify here and just say that, you know, solving zoning problems that we're talking about today isn't going to solve racism in this country. But if you're looking at the same graph I am right now, you're seeing that discriminatory housing policies, a lack of housing affordability that stems from them, falls mostly on folks of color. It falls disproportionately on folks in our community who have been historically disenfranchised. Dialing a little bit back out, we touched on this a minute ago, but high housing prices and really the zoning that they stem from are driving urban sprawl. So if you see these hotbeds here on this graph or on this graphic of population growth, you'll see that not a lot of them are near job centers, right? San Francisco, Oakland, Berkeley, sort of the inner core Bay Area. That's gonna be a problem. It already is a problem really, because it forces people to drive incredibly far distances every day just to get to work, right? We have not built homes where they need to be built, which is near jobs and near transit. So, right, this thing is called urban sprawl when folks have to build and live way far out. This has been the rise of super commuters, right? Folks are driving 2, maybe 3 hours to get to work in the morning and back. Outside of the environmental element, I want to put a pin in that and we'll come back to it, set it aside in your mind. There's a human impact here. How many people here have ever asked a parent for help with homework? Same. This is incredibly helpful. How many folks here have ever had a parent come to, I don't know, a soccer game on a weekday, I suppose? Right. The time you spend with your family is incredibly important. Time you spend with really anyone important in your life is important. And for lots of those folks, this, you know, need to be out of the house before your kids are awake to drive to work, and the inability to get home before dinner's over, means you're not getting that time. It has an incredible impact on just time spent with people you care about. It doesn't have to be this way. So circling back to the environmental issue, who remembers this day in the Bay Area? Yeah, seeing lots of head nods. I want to qualify here and just say that, you know, solving the housing issue isn't going to solve air pollution writ large. But in the state of California, 25% of pollution, carbon emissions that go up into the air, are just people driving to work. It's folks who need to drive long distances to do the job. That's the system we've built. Doesn't have to be this way. So we'll pause here. If there are bigger questions, let's save them until closer to the end. In our breakout rooms, if we have maybe a couple of questions, one or two, I can take them now if they're short. Seeing none. Cool. We'll keep it moving. So this is the good part, right? Solutions. I told you this is a solvable problem. Let's get into how to do it. So basic level, right? We need to make it easier to build more housing. We don't have enough houses. We need to make it easier to build them. And all those houses need to be built at all levels of affordability. I want to be very clear here that, you know, producing a bunch of housing at, you know, a really high rate will not solve this problem. Producing a bunch of low-income housing will not solve this problem. Given the speed that we need to create enough homes, we need to be using every tool in the tool belt to produce enough homes for folks to live in and to create affordability. That starts with enacting pro-housing policies at every level of government. There are four basic fundamentals of pro-housing policies here. Right off the top, we need more funding for things like affordable housing. I mean, really for affordable housing, put simply. We need to reform our regulations, right? Things like Prop 13 that disincentivize housing, we need to reform those. Zoning reform, we spent quite a while on that today. Obviously, we should not be having exclusionary zoning. I think that's just sort of a given. And we need our cities across our region to be collaborating on solving these problems together. Off the top, we need to fund more subsidized affordable housing. Starts with tax reform, right? Prop 13, again, disincentivizes housing being built. Let's solve that. We need more bonds and other one-time revenue sources that can help pay for that housing and help subsidize rents. And we need to make sure that housing projects are, you know, seeing enough fees that they're contributing, but not so many fees that they are impossible to build. Or even if we approve units, we won't build them as homes for people to live in. So again, we need to simplify, update our housing regulations. Streamlining those local housing approval processes, obvious. We just touched on that. We need to update CEQA and Prop 13 for today's housing needs, right? Reforming those laws we just touched on. We need to balance state and local control as well. A major theme of the past few years and really, you know, the sort of golden ticket, actually, I want to be clear. There is no golden ticket to housing solving this problem. But the major thing that has been done at the state level is to say to cities, it's no longer whether or not you want to build housing. You need to build it. You just get to decide where and how it gets built in the city limits. But it's no longer an option to not build the housing we need. We need to reform outdated and exclusionary zoning laws, right? Legalizing multifamily housing citywide, great place to start. I want to note that Berkeley has the birthplace of single family home zoning, is going to probably very likely pass a resolution on February 23rd to end exclusionary zoning. And the way they're going to do it is by doing this. They're going to legalize apartment buildings. We also need to incentivize these small scalable solutions. So I mentioned in-law units earlier, right? Small home that gets built in the backyard of someone's house who wants it. That's a great use of space for cities and regions that need new homes for people. And we need to demand regional collaboration. This top point here, the three P's, this came out of a process called the CASA or Plan Bay Area that then produced the CASA Compact. That was a group of folks brought together who, you know, often come at the housing issue from different angles, and they agreed on these three tenets of solving the housing crisis, housing shortage. Super simple. Production. We need to build enough homes for people to live in. We don't have enough. Protection. We need to ensure that tenants, folks who live in this housing right now and in the future, are protected from eviction. It's an easy one. not an easy one, but it is an important one. Preservation, we need to preserve the number of homes that we have right now so we can add to them. I think that makes sense given what we've all said here. We need to expand and improve public transportation. It is incredibly difficult to use public transportation if you're going really any far distance across the Bay Area. Doesn't have to be that way. We touched on that a minute ago. And we need to provide financial incentives for building more housing regionally. I want to highlight, right, none of these are really radical ideas. This should be pretty simple stuff. It really seems like stuff we should all be able to agree on. We don't, and that's where we're going to get into what we can all do to help. So quickly, I want to acknowledge our new president. I'm personally happy about it. I expect folks are as well. President Biden, what is he doing at the federal level to solve this problem? Well, he does have some ideas. Increasing HUD funding. So increasing funding for subsidies for affordable housing is a massive win, is a huge portion of the amount of money that is needed to build enough homes. Ending zoning laws that perpetuate discrimination. I'm just gonna point back to our single family home zoning thing, right? We shouldn't have exclusionary zoning. It's great to hear that from the White House. We need to expand investments in high quality public transit, right? Joe Biden is the Amtrak president. So far he's shown an incredible awareness that public transit is important and shown a willingness to move towards investing more in it. So this is where the rubber meets the road. What can you do as yourselves, individuals, as a group, representatives in your community? I want to highlight that. And how can HAC be part of that and be helpful? So what you can do, learn about your state and local housing issues. You're doing that right now. Congratulations, step one. It's incredibly important to know about these issues because they're going to affect you, your entire life, if you stay in the Bay Area. This is a long-term solution. We're gonna need folks working on these issues for quite a while and to be very invested in their communities to make it happen. Advocate for new housing development projects in your community. If there's a new building going up in your community and it's 1 to 2 stories or maybe even 3 stories taller than the buildings around it, you can bet that folks are going to come out and say no. And if they're the only voices in the room, they will be heard and listened to. If you can show up to a city council meeting and tell your council member that it's important that there's enough homes for folks to live in your community, you'll be listened to as well. That's the ball game, happens at City Hall. You also need to urge your decision makers to advance pro-housing policies. So right, not the project by project level is awesome, but showing up to your council member's office and saying, I want multifamily housing allowed across the region because I disagree with exclusionary housing policy, incredibly important, especially if you're talking to your council member who will hear you as a constituent. And then team up with other local pro-housing advocates. A large part of what I do for my job is to find folks in the community who care about this issue and to empower them to do their job better, to advocate better. If I show up, if Nico Nagel from Oakland working for Housing Advocate HAC shows up in Berkeley and makes a statement, they already know why I'm there largely. But if you get 20 of your neighbors to show up and say the same thing, it's important and it's heard. So who's HAC? I feel like this is potentially a place to start, but here we are. We are a member-supported nonprofit. We advocate for building more housing at all levels of affordability to help solve our housing shortage and the resulting crises. what we do, like I just said, we advocate for pro housing solutions, partnership with folks like yourselves and our members. We advocate for, activate more pro housing neighbors. We want to find more voices in the community. And we hold those decision makers accountable for their pro housing decisions or their anti-housing decisions. Again, in partnership with you all. So here's the pitch. Why join HAC? It's my job to keep folks informed in the East Bay about timely state and local housing topics. For example, the Berkeley thing. If there's a vote coming up on ending exclusionary zoning, you can bet that I will let you know when it's time to show up. We also provide that same sort of support for new homes in your community. We advocate for new homes at City Hall. It's a very similar thing. We'll help advocate for those pro housing policies, a bunch of those we just touched on. And we'll connect you, if you'd like, with local and state decision makers. And those are just the folks we know, right? It's important that our voice is heard in those offices. And if it's all of our voices, even better. So this is the basic, right? Change is possible when we work together. Groups of folks showing up, making their voice heard about what they want to make their community better on the housing side, that's the ball game. That's it. A couple of things that we've done at HAC. I'm just gonna highlight these bottom two because I've chatted about them quite a bit. We advocated on behalf of new homes at over 50 public meetings in the past year. To do that, we enlisted about 1,500 plus people to show up to City Hall or sign letters or sign a petition, generally make their voice heard to make sure that pro-housing tone is there. We also have different types of events. I'm sure we can get into that in Q&A, but this, for example, is one of those types of events. So if you want to connect with us, stay informed, you can become a friend of HAC. It's $5 a month, $50 a year. You can also subscribe to our newsletter. It's a great place to start. Keep you apprised of all housing news. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn as well. That's the easy stuff. Let's get in real quick to, just looking at the time, these are some additional resources, but I'm actually just gonna go ahead and say we can send these out in a follow-up email. That's cool with everyone? All right, let's do that. Cool, so question time, and not really question time. I think let's jump to our breakout room, one of which will be questions.
I'm just dropping some questions in the chat, and then they're going to correspond to the rooms. And then in the main session, it's just a Q&A. So feel free to join one of the rooms or stick around and ask any questions. And Mara, did you want to ask your question to start us off?
Sure, Anna, I can ask my question. I was wondering if you could speak a bit about how sort of the tech boom in the last 25, 20 years has affected gentrification in Bay Area and maybe like San Francisco, Oakland specifically.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm gonna flip back earlier to a slide in a reference. So tech boom. Right, we get this question a lot. Obviously, you hear a bunch about tech drives gentrification. I would say sure, but it's due to the fact that we have not built enough homes for those folks to live in. I want to flag here, right? Tech jobs. There are new jobs that have come to an area during a booming economy. I think it's really hard to make the case against a booming economy. right? It's brought so much wealth to this region, so much wealth that we could be harnessing better. And I think the counter argument is difficult to make. For example, although it has been made, I want to be clear. There's a story of a former planner and attorney living in the city of Palo Alto who was priced out of her community, priced out of the city of Palo Alto. I want to highlight the fact that she was an attorney and her husband was also an attorney. They're well-educated, probably, you know, making enough money to live in an area. And they were priced out. And as she left, this woman wrote, you know, basically wrote the op-ed that said, this is due to the fact that we have not built enough homes. We have not, in the city of Palo Alto, has not built enough homes to accommodate folks who want to live here. And the mayor of Palo Alto, in return, said, no, the problem is we have too many good jobs, right? Having too many good jobs drives up the housing price. I want to acknowledge that, you know, theoretically, he's correct. If you drag down demand, then it pulls down price. But I think it's really hard to make the case against a booming economy. Tech is sort of a similar thing. But I would point you back to this graph we looked at, which says that areas that saw gentrification, it correlated with not building enough homes for people. And that's just kind of, I mean, that's kind of it. Like, we don't build enough homes for folks to live in, and the folks who can afford those homes at a higher price will pay that higher price, and it will force people out. Sorry, a bit of a ramble there, but this graph is what I wanted to point you back to.
How much do you think like the pandemic has decreased demand versus just like putting people in terrible situations, et cetera?
So I think, I mean, it's obviously decreased demand. I want to start here. I think it's still a little early to know the effects of the pandemic because it's not over. But what we do know is that we've seen folks moving away at a higher rate. We have seen housing prices fall accordingly. I want to note though that, you know, at the lowest point of those the housing price dip, it was nowhere near what we would call affordable. It was still incredibly difficult to afford a home here. That just goes to show in my mind that we have plenty more work to do producing enough homes for folks to live in to achieve affordability.
Sort of relating to Kyan's question. I know a few months ago, there was like a lot of talk about like this like flight from the cities. I know the Chronicle wrote a lot about it, like people moving out of the cities now that jobs are online, or some jobs are online. How much impact long-term do you think that that's gonna have, if it's even a real thing that's big enough to affect the housing crisis?
Yeah, really, really good question. And a question that I've asked people smarter and more informed than myself. I want to really quickly just start here, say I'm again not an economics expert, I don't think I could produce the reliable model in the next few minutes here, but we don't know really what that issue is going to be. Like, yes, we have seen we've seen lots of companies, I think most notably Salesforce in the past week, is changing policy to allow more work from home options. But again, you know, there are lots of jobs that aren't tech in the Bay Area. Not everyone can work from home. And so, you know, could there be an impact on the economy? Sure. Could that be reflected in housing prices? Absolutely. But I would say we don't know what that's going to be yet. And that doesn't go for everyone across the Bay Area.
I know you talked about like redlining and all that, and for like a like community of San Francisco in the Bay Area that like sort of sees themselves as really diverse. It's like largely segregated in our neighborhoods. And so I was wondering like what solutions or like ideas you have for combating the effects of redlining.
Yeah, so there's a few different slides we could touch on here. And I'm gonna point you back to this. Actually, I'm gonna point you back to the solution slide on it. Here we go. We spend a lot of time in the city of San Francisco talking about whether housing should be built in places that allow multifamily housing, right, that are zoned for apartment buildings. It's a little disingenuous though, because we're having an argument with 1.5 arms tied behind our back, because we can only build that housing in 25% of the city. So we're not even working with every tool we could have. And that you know, compounds issues in areas that allow for housing. The alternative is we allow multifamily housing to be built across the entire city of San Francisco. We legalize that multifamily housing and we produce enough of it so that it's affordable. And that gives the opportunity for historically disenfranchised folks to potentially afford homes in other neighborhoods. Higher opportunity neighborhoods is actually what I want to highlight here. That is sort of the citywide solve for this. It's literally allow people to live other places and allow the homes that they need to live in to be built in those places. Hope that answers your question.
I have a question. Go ahead. Okay, thanks. So, you know, obviously getting more affordable housing is a good thing. Why are politicians so hesitant to make it work? Like, why would they try to, is it like just because it's a socialism?
Yeah, so this is a great question. I'm going to quickly draft. Corey, are you on right now, by the way? Sorry, our deputy director, yep. Corey Smith, incredibly smart political mind on the issue. So I'm going to draft him to take this one.
Hey, all, Corey. I am the deputy director at HAC. I mean, I think two pieces. Number one, some politicians are supportive and some politicians aren't. So it does depend on the person. There's plenty that are really passionate, really strong affordable housing advocates. The folks that aren't, or at least they don't vote that way, are mostly acting that way, honestly, because of constituencies that are active and loud that speak up against affordable housing in communities or housing generally. So more than anything else, I think they're responding to folks that vote for them. And
I'm just gonna say here, this is why it's important that folks like yourselves organize your communities to go tell politicians that they could lose votes for voting the other way too. or that be the implication. Make sure it's known that it's important that this issue is solved by those decision makers.
Thank you.
You bet. Thanks, Corey.
I've heard about like people like investing in real estate in the Bay Area just as like, I don't know, some sort of stable investment. Is that like a real thing? If so, do you think that's overinflated the demand and like the price of like Bay Area housing?
So yeah, so this is a good question. It's a talking point that's out there, of course. I'm gonna tell you what I know to be true, the data that I know to be true. In the city of Berkeley, right, this is made as a counter argument all the time to new housing, right? The argument is we can't even fill enough housing, all the housing that we have. Why would we create more? Like, let's finish what's on our plate. The city of Berkeley has lower than a 5% vacancy rate. So it's hard to believe that, you know, homes are just sitting empty. That's the data I know, and I'm sure that could vary to one degree or another by city. But that's what I know of Berkeley. When I show up to Berkeley City Council, it's hard for me to buy that argument.
This is just like a more personal question, but like, how did you become interested in like working in this field?
Oh, no personal questions. No, sorry. No, super good question. So I'm from the South Bay, from Mountain View. I went to school in Connecticut, in the city of Hartford, at a small school called Trinity College. There I was part of what's called the Cities Program. And it's sort of, it's liberal arts' way of making you take a bunch of different classes to learn about housing from, or to learn about cities from a bunch of different angles. In that process, and in interning at their city hall and spending some time at the state house there as an intern, it became incredibly obvious to me that the golden ticket in terms of achieving equity will fall somewhere in the realm of land use. How we use our land, who gets approval over those uses. Land is our most valuable, most finite, most obvious resource in my mind. For example, there, it is the most segregated state in the country, state of Connecticut. And that has large parts to do with the fact that they did away with county systems in 1960. That made it impossible to redistribute funding between cities. Practical example, Avon High School, the public high school in the town of Avon, regularly competes with national and international private schools on merit and funding per student and achievement per student. Because there's no mechanism to redistribute that wealth to cities that need it. For example, the city of Hartford, the capital city in Connecticut, has almost had to declare bankruptcy, at least when I was in college, twice. Can anybody else think of a state where the capital city is close to bankruptcy? Does anybody think that's a good idea? Seems like maybe towns like Avon could move that money around a little bit, help other folks achieve. Those are all land use decisions. And so it stuck somewhere in the back of my head that land use is the ticket, it's the ball game, it's the whole thing. And after college, it was like, you know, if I'm going to work on a policy issue, it's going to be, there's one. There's the really obvious one. And so that's how I got involved. I met our executive director, intern there. I sort of stumbled into the job, to be perfectly honest with you. But it's a great time to say that decisions are made by those who show up, and I kind of just kept showing up.
Perfect. I think we're just gonna close out now since it's 2. But if there's any last thing that you wanna say, Nico, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, I just wanna say, you know, thank you guys for having me. And these are always fun. It's great to see folks getting involved. Big shout out to Lucy, who, if you have not read her op-ed, you absolutely should. Lucy, is it cool if I include that in the blast?
Sure.
Hell yes. Okay. Yeah, and just, again, decisions are made by those who show up. Please stay involved. Obviously, bonus points if you advocate for housing in your communities. And I'm happy to be helpful with that. Guitarist from Radiohead, bet. Love it.
Yeah, thank you all for coming. And be sure to like stay in touch with us through our Instagram or website. I think Amelia just dropped SFHAC's website as well. Yeah, thank you everyone. And thank you, Nico.
Yep, thank you guys as well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks for coming, everyone.
Cool. Did you, oh wait, let me stop.